Really touched by what you said. Yes, I CFTRI was one of my favorite laboratories, by the way. I visited it a number of times. The accolades and what you have done for the country from CFTRI, including what you referred to as Amul, the buffalo milk based product that we created for India. Was phenomenal, and there have been so many other amazing accomplishments. And I'm very happy and proud to see what started as a small research rice research center, the way Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology has grown and will soon become the pride of India in terms of an institute of national eminence and national importance. To me, you are already an institute of national importance. You know, I think the government will just formally certify it, that's all. Because I watched your amazing work that you have done over a period of time. And you know, your past has been glorious, and I'm quite sure that your future will be even more glorious. I'm also grateful to you that you gave me an opportunity to pay my tributes to revered Dr. V. Subramaniam. You know, it's incredible. The only job I have done in my life is CSR. I did nothing else in my life, really. And therefore, CSR is at my heart. And I always say, once a CSR, always a CSR. And if you see the way CSR was built by these great personalities, it is incredible. I mean, just can you imagine V. Subramaniam going to the Maharaja of Mysore and getting this particular palace and converting this palace magically in just 22 months into a lab. And you know, we talk about multiple of crores. That day, I understand 1949-50, his capital budget was 3 lakhs and the recovery, I mean, the operational budget was 1.2 lakhs. Can you just imagine? He started with 6-7 sort of scientists and created such a magnificent laboratory. You talked about one of the great features of his life, which is that he kept on working till the last day of his life. In fact, you know, I have these 5 Mashalkar mantras that I always give to young students. And all of them want instant success, like instant coffee. And I tell them there is nothing like instant success, like instant coffee. There's no substitute to hard work. And I always tell them that all my life I worked hard. I worked 24/7, day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year. And I shall continue to do so till I breathe my last. And that's exactly what revered Dr. V. Subramaniam did. In fact, I was having an interaction with some young people on the other day. I meet them very often because that makes me also feel young, you know, there is a selfish interest. So one of them said, and in fact, post-COVID, I've been working twice as hard as I was pre-COVID, because it's now all zooming in and zooming out, and it's absolutely incredible the way the life has gone. So they said, look, you achieved so much in your life and you are working twice as hard now, why? So I gave them a response, which I thought I will repeat, because some of the people of my age who might be there in the audience might take some inspiration from that. I said, look, today I'm 78. So when I was 28, I would say there are 50 years to go. But now I'm 78, I don't even know whether I have 5 years to go. So what I achieved in 50 years, I have to achieve in 5 years. So when you become old, you work harder, 10 times harder, basically, you know. And that, I think, is the important sort of message for nation building, devoting every ounce that you have, giving back to the society till the end. That's what revered Dr. Subramaniam did. And I think that's That's a great lesson for us. So I feel really privileged to pay my homage, my respects to this builder of not only CFTRI, not only IIFPT, but I would say a nation builder. I would put him in a much higher orbit. I am not a sort of a food technologist or a food scientist, so I'm not going to talk about food at all. I like to talk about subject that I sort of understand. But, my friend Prakash has this great persuasive power. So 2-3 years ago, he came to me and he said, you must give the keynote in the IFOST, this International Union for Food Science and Technology. Sure. And I remember that lecture, and that is available. And Dr. Anand Ramakrishnan, I will send that lecture to you. And that lecture had a dream. As a theme, and it was 25 billion meals a day by 2025, healthy, nutritious, safe, and diverse. And I had shown the way on how one can achieve it, and I had given two mantras of mine. One was more from less for more. How do you do that? And also there was an assured framework. If we follow that, like affordable, scalable, sustainable, user friendly, rapid, excellent in terms of technology, and distinctive. And I'd shown how the current technologies sort of fall, and said that if you use these two mantras, you can achieve this particular dream. I'll be happy to share it with you, and you might sort of share it with others. I am quite able to see, I always think in terms of not incremental, but disruptive, game-changing innovation and sort of technology. So I'm a 10x guy. 10x means 10 times better and 10 times cheaper. And I'm very happy to say what I like to call as affordable excellence. India is fantastic in creating affordable excellence. Very high quality products at very sort of low cost. But for doing what looks like impossible, you also have to change the way you do things. For example, I'll pull out this book from my library. This is called Leapfrogging to Pole Vaulting. This book won the Business Book of the Year last year and has inspired many, including our chief of staff. He said on the other day that nation should follow this leap. What was the idea there? Why does the frog leap? The frog leaps because he's afraid of his predator. Okay, and jumps a few feet. And what we are seeing in this book is that, no, don't do that. Just don't jump in a sort of to protect yourself a few feet. But pole vault. The size of the pole determines the size of your aspiration. Okay. And we demonstrate as to how India has done it in many, many ways indeed. And then I talked about not just the best practice, the next practice. Because if you are following somebody's best practice, then you become a follower. How do you create the next practice? Because the world is changing very rapidly. See, to my limited understanding, if you see even in food technology, and these will be my last remarks on food that I dare to speak in front of all the eminent experts here, I can quite clearly see that current best practice will move to the next practice. Like, for example, the current practice is traditional offline platforms that we use. The future is, of course, the digital platforms. The current best practice is, of course, rural agriculture, but urban agriculture will sort of creep up. Today, we look at food as a product. Food is going to be a service. Today, the farming is done in traditional way. It will be done, maybe vertical farming will come up, and a whole range of other things, indoor farms and so on and so forth. Today, we have lifestyle-based diet, but tomorrow there may be DNA-based sort of diets. Today, we are looking at slaughterhouse meat, which creates such a huge carbon footprint, as you know. We may go for lab-grown meat. Synthetic foods are not far away. What I am saying, wish to say, is that we should be always ahead of the curve rather than follow. My dream is always that India must lead and not just follow. So I'm quite sure whether it is IFPT or the CFTRI, my entire CSR, we have to be able to do that. I'm very proud that when Jan Nagrika's book, Scientific Age, listed the top 10 achievements of Indian science and technology. I remember the first was Ramanujan, of course, and then Meghnad Saha for the stellar astrophysics, and S.N. Bose, as you know, we talk about boson particle and so on, then Sir C.V. Raman for the Nobel Prize and so on and so forth. And among the 10, there was one which was CSR transformation that took place in 90s, okay? And I'm very happy, Dr. Anand Ramakrishnan, that you talk about 1999 when you were at CFTRI. You are a part of this great transformation that we did. And I'm very proud to see the way CSR has reacted. We have a fantastic director general, Shekhar Mande, by the way. Extraordinarily inspiring, really people's director general. And can you just imagine the way CSR reacted to COVID, creating almost 100 technologies in 100 days? It is absolutely sort of a phenomenal contribution by CSR. So CSR always rises to the occasion, and I've been very proud of having been sort of a part of it. I would go back to my main theme of the talk, and that is that we have had COVID, and this has been an unprecedented, I would say, you know, we talk about VUCA word, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, right? I don't think there was a greater VUCA year than 2020. The way the sort of thing changed overnight. Overnight, you saw within 100 days, 100 million families moved from poverty to extreme poverty. What it meant was that so many years of work just went down the drain in just 100 days. If you saw 1.6 billion children just went out of school, and online learning became, now one third of them don't have access to either the iPad or smartphone or laptop or what have you. So that means no access to education. So can you imagine 1.6 billion children being deprived of education? It's amazing. Lives were lost, livelihoods were lost, you know. Work from home became sort of a new a normal. Work home became the school, the office, the theater, everything. And of course, when you are in such a situation, you have to also say, what do I do now? And therefore, we are restarting, we are rebuilding, we are recovering. But we don't want to recover to the same old state, as a matter of fact. I think this is a chance for us to rethink and reimagine the new India that we will create. We have to also see what you know, what are the lessons from this pandemic? Because if you see the pandemic, you know, I think it provides a trailer for what will happen if a full-fledged climate crisis would entail. Because what would happen if a full-fledged climate crisis is there? There will be huge disruptions on the demand side, which took place now. There will be huge disruptions on the supply side, which took place now. And there will be huge speeds of global transmission, global amplification, which took place now. Can you just imagine the new virus strain in Britain, for example? Within no time, it has been there in 17 countries. Can you just sort of imagine this globally connected world, how it sort of basically changes? So I think we have to reimagine, reinvent a new world and a new India. And our most inspiring Prime Minister, of course, has given us the mantra, Atmanirbhar Bharat. And he has given it for a good reason, as I will explain shortly. But I would say that Atmanirbhar Bharat, self-reliant India, does not mean that we have to protect ourselves with huge tariff barriers like we did several years ago, not in isolation, but we have to integrate with the global supply chain, all right? And therefore, we have to look at Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atma Vishwas and Atma Samman. What does that mean? Self-reliant India with self-confidence that we can do it, and also self-respect, self-dignity. So this is an opportunity to rethink and reimagine India. The other thing is we always talk in terms of buy or make, all right? But reinventing India, we'll have to think in terms of five pillars. You know what are those five pillars? One is buy, second is make, third is buy to make better, fourth is make to buy better, and fifth is make it together. I'll explain to you, because we are otherwise thinking just of, see, what does buy mean? That means you go and beg and borrow a technology, and you are dollars and you buy. And I can assure you that even if you are dollars, people will not use it. I remember I was on the board of directors of IPCL. We wanted Alpha Olefin technology. Why Alpha Olefin? Because Alpha Olefin sulfonates were biodegradable detergents. Okay, so we went to Idemitsu in Japan, Shell in Europe, you know, Chevron in US. Nobody gave us the technology. Why? They didn't want India to be a bottomless demand, of course, we have, but a competitor. So even when you want technology, they will not give you. So, for example, 5G, I'm very happy that we are developing our own technology. We heard the announcement by Mr. Mukesh Ambani on that. So that is buying part of it. Secondly, make. Of course, we have been making, but make in India cannot be assembled in India. It has to be invented in India. Why? Otherwise, you'll be wiped off. Let me give you an example. We are making mobiles in India. In 2015, I mean, there were companies like Micromax and Carbon and so on. You know how much was our share? 45%. Okay? And today, you know what it is? From 45% to 9%. Why? What happened? Who ate away our land? Chinese. Chinese came in 2015 when we were 45%, they were just 7%. Today from 7%, they are 68%. All right? And how much are we? Just 9%. So we have gone down and they have gone up. Why? Because we were just assembling. If you make in India just as an assembly in India, it will not work. You have to invent. And they created new models, making them more user-friendly, getting the advanced technologies and so on and so forth. So there is no substitute to research and innovation. When we talk about Make in India, it is invent in India. That is the new India that we have to see. The third is buying to make better. You know, for example, transistor. We always talk about Sony. But Sony was the transistor was the American technology. They were the American patents that Sony bought, and they made so much better that they became number one. Okay, so it is not just buying technology, it is buying components. I was hearing Rahul Bajaj on the other day, and he exports 15,000 crore worth two-wheelers. But he says, I import some components from China, some 600 plus 400 crore with his vendors, which is about 1,000 crore. So his 15,000 crore export depends upon 1,000 crore sort of import. But he takes them and then creates a better way. So what are the three things I have talked to you so far? Buying, making, and buying to make better. But there is something called making to buy better. Okay. And in that making to buy better, what we do is that we develop technological competence so that the others are forced to give the technology to us. Like Alpha Olefin, you know, I said they did not give us the technology. But I remember I was IPCL director and we were doing work on Alpha Olefin and we had got a breakthrough in catalyst. We are going for a pilot plant and some finance guy stopped us for some reason. And then somebody who was traveling with me told me that, look, it was a person from Chevron. He said, we are watching you very closely. If you had gone up to pilot plan, we knew you will go forward and then you will become competitor and then you would have given the technology so that you don't have your own technology. Can you just imagine that? So that is the fourth thing we have to do. And the last one is making it together, like all of us do, you know, CFTRI partner, IFP partner, all our laboratories partnering as a Team India spirit. So I think the first point I want to make is that we have to ensure that all these five mantras are actually followed. The other point I want to sort of talk about is the confidence that I have. You know, people call me a dangerous optimist. But why am I dangerously optimistic? When our COVID pandemic came, we were completely unprepared. There were no diagnostic, there were no vaccine, there were no drugs, there were no personal protection equipment, these, that, and that. We are dependent upon China's of this world and so on and so forth. But just see what a transformation we have made. If you looked at the Indian challenges, what were the Indian challenges? Let me take you through, because this is very inspiring. That's why I'm very proud of Indian science. You know, the first challenge was that we had limited availability of quality test kits. In fact, the state-run labs, when it came, they were running at 36% capacity and the private labs were doing some 8 tests a day. And in fact, they were a headline because then we had to look for outside, no? And then there was a queue. And in Bloomberg, I found a headline which said, India finds itself at the back of the line for virus test kits, because we are in the queue, but we are there. From there, what we did was phenomenal. Here in Pune, there is this MyLab, a startup. And I will tell you, the startups have been a tremendous source of talent and technology. Within 6 weeks, they created the new RT-PCR. And within 3 months, they tested 1.2 sort of million. And it was 3 times cheaper than the imported one. And 95% components were indigenous. So therefore, when our Prime Minister says, Atmanirbhar Bharat, we should not depend upon the others, this was a classical case. And then we have seen the new breakthroughs that have actually come up. What was the second challenge? Second challenge was that we had these high-risk individuals we had to sort of basically identify. And Dharavi, if you remember, it had the Asia's biggest slum, you know, and their social distancing was absolutely impossible. And people had said that it is a ticking bomb, it will go. But in Los Angeles Times, there was headline, you know, what are that? While coronavirus spread in US, an Indian slum with 1 million residents contained it. Can we learn something from them? Can you just imagine that? Okay. Now, how was that possible? Because they had this testing, tracing, and isolation done, and rapid testing. And again, startups came up. For example, CureDate AI, you know, it could detect COVID-19. Within less than 1 minute, just for a couple of dollars. So mass screening was done, isolation was done, and it was incredible. It's a matter of pride, you know. I'm sure the Harvard Business Review will write a case study on something like how such a miracle could take place. Similarly, there were limited ICU beds, basically. And today, you can see the suffering, by the way. I will read out something to you. And I want you to guess as to which country it must have been, this headline. It says, the situation here is dire. Every minute, 10 people test positive for COVID-19. Every minute. Every 8 minutes, someone dies. Every 8 minutes. Ambulances circle for hours, unable to find ERs that can accept patients. Hospitals are running out of oxygen. ICU capacity is at zero. Patients lie in hallways and tents. Emergency room nurses have more patients than they can handle, sometimes 6 at a time. Have a guess. All of you must be thinking what country it must be, and or what you must be thinking, oh, it must be some remote village in Africa or India or some developing world. I'm sorry. This is Los Angeles. This is California. A region which has a $68,000 GDP per capita. Ours is 2,000, no? 34 times richer. Why did that happen? It happened because of lack of scientific temper. Virus doesn't walk to you. You can use mask. You keep distance of 2 meters. You wash your hands. What's so big in it? This is what science said, but they refuse to sort of do that. And what are the consequences? You can quite clearly see. But the important part I want to say, I mean, the reason I'm saying is that how much better we have done. People just, we are so self-critical, we just don't understand how well we have done. So when they say ICU capacity is at zero, here is an Indian creating ICU capacity. You know, in my mother's name, I have created Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Awards, Inclusive Innovation. And they are all given for people who make high technology work for the poor. Okay, because making high technology work for the rich, very easy. Making low technology work for the poor, very easy. But making high technology work for the poor is very difficult. So they create such technologies. Okay, I'll give you one instance, because you might wonder what it is. And as I said, I don't believe in best practice, I believe in next practice. So here is a next practice one. You know, this was in the 10 years of journey, we are given a number of awards, 13 awards, and one of them was Rahul Rastogi. What did he do? And I'm mentioning this to you specifically because this has to be the characteristics of Indian innovation, Indovation, as I call it. So he, Rahul Rastogi, his father used to have some heart issues, so he had to be taken for ECG. He would lie down in the bed. I mean, if they're there, then those 12 leads are put, as you know, there is a nurse who takes a reading, half an hour goes, then you get a paper readout. He's an electronic wizard. He said, why should I create ECG machine, which I can keep in my pocket? And he created one. This is the machine. How does it operate? You know, you have this, you put your two thumbs for just 15 seconds. Then there is a sensor, as you can see. This is your heart. You put it here, 15 seconds, 15 seconds, 15 seconds. And below the heart, 15 seconds, 15 seconds, 15 seconds. So within 3 minutes, if you have downloaded an app called Sanket, like I have, the ECG goes, via that digital transmission. So imagine what it means that in a village, when an old woman has a pain and she has to be put in a bullet cart or a scooter or a jeep and taken several kilometers, you don't have to do that. It's like using an advanced thermometer and you can get it. And this is US certified and it's amazing. So user friendly and so on. So that's an Indian innovation, a portable ECG. And you can buy it, by the way, this Sanket Life. It is available for just 2,500 rupees, but the cost per ECG turns out to be just 5 rupees, not 500 rupees. That's why I talk about affordable excellence as the key for Indian innovation. Because normally we say, oh, if it is affordable, it can't be excellent. If it is excellent, it can't be affordable. India does the trick. 10 times better, but 10 times cheaper, like this particular device. So when you talk about ICU, one of this year's award went to one innovation called Dozy. Well, what they have done is that if you have a bed, you know, he uses Internet of Things, IoT, and where with the sensor-based system, you just slip it under the sink, and 7 of your vital parameters are sort of measured. And if you put that probe on oxygen, even oxygen is monitored, and all done remotely. At what cost? 5% of the cost of water. And what accuracy? 98.4% medical accuracy of those vital parameter. Now you can quite clearly see what it means. So any bed, as a matter of fact, within less than 5 minutes can be converted into a stand-up sort of ICU. US should be looking at things like what this Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award, because they are saying ICU capacity as zero. I mean, you can convert your bed at home in sort of an ICU. This is the power of Indian innovation. What were the other challenge that we had? You look at, for example, our conditions. Look at the ventilators. I'm saying all this because you must feel proud about the way Indian science rose. You look at ventilators. We're all importing them, basically. And what are the conditions in villages? No compressed medical air, either no power or frequent power cuts, limited trained staff, etc. Now, this is where the private sector comes in. You know, Marico Innovation Foundation, I've been its chairman for last 17 years from 2003, 18 now. And they came out with a grand challenge prize of 2.5 crore. And I chaired that committee to select. And it's amazing, this NOCCA, Shreyas and KPIT, they came out with ventilators, which are fraction of the cost, 10% of the cost of those ventilators. All right, of a high quality, which can work even when there is no compressed medical air, frequent power cuts, and limited trained staff. And now suddenly, they are getting orders abroad. As our Honorable Prime Minister says, make in India, but for the world. And what will take it? Affordable, it will help our poor, but excellence, if it matches the world quality, world will be. And there's a demand now. Why I'm giving this to you, you know, like personal protection equipment, PPEs, we're importing them, as a matter of fact, mostly from China. And within 2 months of pandemic, we created PPEs. We were actually in 60 days, I would say. There's a headline which says in 60 days, our PPE production goes 56x. And we have created a $1 billion industry now. And we actually exported 2.3 million in the month of July. So an importing country becoming exporting. It's the same thing with vaccines, as you see. I sit in Pune and everybody is looking at Serum Institute for providing this thing. And there is what is called as a vaccine diplomacy. India is giving vaccines to the whole world. And of course, Serum is producing the Oxford AstraZeneca, but we have Bharat Biotech, our own vaccine also coming up. I think the point I want to make is that India is always tested during adversity. And how that adversity was converted into an opportunity, I think is a story that will be remembered for a long time. And I'm very happy that India has actually demonstrated to the rest of the world in terms of what we can do. We have the talent, we have the technology. All that we need to have is the trust, I would say. There are two, three other points that I want to make before I close. See, one of the issues that bothers me is our very heavy dependence on China, by the way. Because what's happening is that, I will give you some figures. And that is where Prime Minister's Atmanirbhar Bharat becomes very critical. Now, if you look at the Chinese dependence in pharma, you know, people look at us like a pharmacy of the world, right? We supply the cheapest and the highest quality generic drugs to the rest of the world, basically. But we are very dependent upon China. If you look at APIs, which are active pharmaceutical ingredients, which are used in making these, 70% of them come from China. So if China stops it tomorrow, what happens? China raises the prices, what happens? And therefore, this Atmanirbhar Bharat, and that's why the government has come out with a great scheme to make us kind of independent. Now, I can understand that happening in API, but in electronics, 45%. Manufactured capital goods, 32%. In furniture, 53%. Why? What's so great about it? All right. So somehow or the other, you know, when I say reinvent new India, reimagine and reinvent New India, I think these are the ground realities that we have to take into account and very rapidly move towards a real Atmanirbhar Bharat. There is another issue that I want to flag before you in terms of how we need to move on technology. And why, in fact, I have just commented on the science technology innovation policy. a wonderful policy that the draft is circulating at the moment. And I had almost a 90-minute discussion with the team who has drafted it yesterday. And one of the important points I want to make is the following. And that is, we have the challenge of moving from ideas to impact, from mind to marketplace. And there are several factors for which we need to build national innovation ecosystem. I told you about the children not having either the digital gadgets or not having connectivity, okay, and therefore being deprived of education. But if you just go back, you know, there was this computer which came out in 2001. It was a low-cost alternative to PC, shared device that permitted truly simple and natural user interface, you know. And most importantly, we always say that we follow the others. No, sorry, this was leading the others. What iPhone did later, it had done earlier, what is called as an accelerometer, you know. What Samsung Galaxy did later, that is Bangalore Mail, you know, the ability to write on phone, they had done it. So in 2001, here was something which was ahead of iPhone, which was ahead of Samsung, okay? And in fact, the Bruce Sterling of New York Times, I'm very proud to tell you, had said that the most significant innovation in computer technology was not Apple's gleaming PowerBook 4G, nor was it Microsoft Windows XP, it was Simputer, a NetLink radically simple portable computer, you know, which was intended to bring revolution in the developing world. Have you heard of Simputer now? Has it brought the revolution? No. Because what happens is that there is what is called as a talent, technology, and trust. And that trust in an innovation like this is shown by government becoming the first buyer. So supposing these 10,000 of these computers were brought, you know, this team would have got started. You would have got a market feedback. You created, must have created a new sort of product which would be ahead of this world, like Bruce Sterling basically said, we lost that opportunity. Then, of course, later on, you must have heard about Akash, you know, $35. Can you imagine it was mass manufactured, basically. Today, why $35? It should be available in $10, which poor people could have sort of afforded. And that, why it bothers me that I saw the newspaper report on the other day when 15-year-old girls, boys have committed suicide because they don't have smartphones. You know, pathetic. There is one Kuldeep Kumar in Himachal Pradesh who sold his only cow for 6,000 rupees to buy. Why? We had all these technologies and therefore we require, when we say Startup India, etc., we have to ensure that they are backed up. There is what is called a talent, technology, and trust. Some other, there is a society. When I talk about not just reimagine, reinvent ourselves, that trust in our products, we have to believe in. I'll give you an example, you know, just to show what societal mindset has to change in the reinvented India. One of the 10 Inclusive Innovation Awardees of Anjali Mashirkar Award was Naveen Khanna. What did he do? I hope none of you have had dengue, but if you had dengue, you would have found that once you submit your sample, it takes a couple of days, 1 or 2 days to get the results, right? What he did is that within 15 minutes, you come to know whether you are infected and also at what stage you are, because you had a remarkable marker and cheapest possible, by the way. It was a technology and US patents and so on. It was a technology which nobody would work. Nobody would touch it, although it was superior. We were importing from South Korea, from Australia, and from US. And then suddenly a pandemic broke up. And all the kids started getting exhausted. And then we approached these three countries. Two of them said, no, we will take time. South Korea said, yes, we'll supply. They put it in a ship, you know. And they put it in a wrong ship, which went actually to Africa. So India, there was no the thing at all. So we had no option but to go for Navin Khanna's technology. Okay? And today, from 0% market share, he is 78% market share. But supposing that ship had come here, he would be still 0%. So what I'm saying is that we have talent like Navin Khanna, like the Silputer team. We have technology, like what I just now mentioned. We have to have trust in ourselves, you know. And that trust has to be built by giving them a chance. I chair this Maharashtra State Innovation Society. And for startups, we have changed the tendering process because you are always asking for experience, this, that, and the other, etc. It is almost like, you know, Sachin Tendulkar, when he was 15 in Ranji Trophy, he scored a century, right? But then somebody, the body would say, but where is your 10-year experience before we put you into test? See, it cannot work. You have to give our young a chance. You have to trust them. If that happens, I think then we as a country are on. That's the only further message I want to give because you will have children, you will have young people around you. Please trust them. Please trust them. You know, they will do us proud. I want to end by giving, because many people ask me, you know, you are now 78 and you have learned so much. So can you tell us 5 lessons from the book of your life? So these are my 5 mantras, by the way, Mashalkar mantras, and I will end with that. The first mantra is, aspirations are your possibilities. Keep them high. Okay. I remember when I became the director of NCL as one of the CSR labs, you know that. 1989, I became the director. And at that time, what was the situation? This was 2 years before 1991. And we were all doing import substitution, reverse engineering, copying, to be honest. And we did well. I mean, for example, the Green Revolution would not have taken place if there were no agrochemicals. And 70% of the agrochemicals were created by CSR. So that was not bad. But I remember, I said, because whenever we developed some technology which was ahead of the rest of the world, and I went to industry, they would say, but have they done it? There was no confidence. So I said, where am I selling? Where am I selling? Why should I be selling in India only my technologies? The whole world. And on the very first day, and the speech is there, by the way, on the NCL website, where I said, let National Chemical Laboratory buy International Chemical Laboratory. Okay? And we'll export our knowledge to the rest of the world. And for some reason, I talked about GE, General Electric, you know? And I was reading something, and I said, we should be able to license our patents to GE also, because I'm a polymer person, you know, I was seeing something. And you know something, it's incredible. Somebody came to me, young fellow, and said, sir, do you realize their R&D budget is 2.5 times India's R&D budget? I said, it's not the power of budget, it's the power of idea that matters. This I said in 1989. In 1991, 3 of our US patents, we licensed them for $3 million. In polycarbonates, where they had 40% market share, by the way. So we could license, our mind is such that we could create something which we could offer to the best in the world, the leader in the world, as a matter of fact. We are capable of that. And same laboratory which was doing reverse engineering copy. So that is because we raised our aspirations. We said we'll not be National Chemical Laboratory, we'll be International Chemical. That's the first one. Secondly, perseverance pays. Too early to give up. Winners are never quit. Winners never quit, and quitters never win. So I always tell everybody, fail, F-A-I-L. All right? It is first attempt in learning. First attempt in learning. Your best guru is your last mistake, as long as you are able to learn from. That is second Mashalkar mantra. And I have used it in my life. Third, I told you about hard work. You know, no substitute to hard work. Like instant coffee, there is no instant success. But the only thing I tell my young friends is that work hard in silence. Let success make all the noise. You know. My fourth Mashalkar mantra is, don't keep on knocking on the door of opportunity. If they don't open, create your own doors. Once again, I'll give you my personal example. When I came back in 1976, I was trained in rheology, as was mentioned, right? I wanted to buy a Weizenberg rheogoniometer, model R18. I still remember the model number. It would take 2 years to get it. Digitally clearance, not manufactured in India certificate. Can you just imagine? Then that door was not opening. So what did I do? I said, I will go into modeling and simulation, where I use only this. I'm not importing anything from anywhere. I have it already. And can you imagine, I started the work in 77, and Bhatnagar work is given for 5 years of work. In 82, I got the Bhatnagar. Now, had I kept like this and waiting for that door to open, what would happen? I created my own door. So that is my fourth lesson. And the fifth lesson, the final one, is no limit, as was shown on my website, no limit to human imagination, no limit to human endurance, no limit to human achievement. And we have seen that, like no limit to human endurance. You saw that young girl, you know, who drove her father on a bicycle, injured father on a bicycle for Jyoti Paswan, you know, from Himachal Pradesh to Bihar, 1200 kilometers in 8 days. It's incredible. So no limit to human endurance. So I'll end by telling you a story. You know, I became FRS, Fellow of Royal Society. As was mentioned, there are only three engineering scientists from in 360 years who have become. So I was very happy, and Professor C.N.R. Rao is my guru, you know, our Bharatatna Professor C.N.R. Rao. Guru, guide, friend, philosopher, everything he has been. Whatever I am is because of these gurus that are there, including my mother and Professor Sharma and others. So I phoned him up. I thought he will say great and so on and so forth. Nothing. He said, not bad. I was very disappointed. Then I became American Academy of Arts and Science, you know, and this was 1780 onwards, and Benjamin Franklin and George Washington had created it. There are 200 Nobel laureates and people from Charles Darwin to Winston Churchill and whole India. And only seven Indians have become so far. So I was the seventh. So I called Professor Sinha. I thought he would say great. He said, not bad. I was very disappointed. Then at least here there were third and seventh. The National Academy of Inventors, US, by the way. I was first Indian to become one. So I thought, now he will say great. I called him. Again, his answer was, not bad. Then I got upset. I said, sir, what do I have to do to impress you? What he told then, what he said then, is going to be my last line. What he said is that, he calls me my first name, Ramesh. My name is Raghunath Mashelkar, but people who are close to me call me Ramesh. He says, Ramesh, you are climbing on a ladder of excellence, which has no limit, accepting the limit you put on yourself. See what a great message it is. What it tells you is that your best is yet to come. Your best is yet to come. So my message today, slightly different from the one Professor Anandaram Krishnan that you remember, is the following. No matter what happens, we have to say, my best is yet to come. So whether you are in your 20s or 30s or 40s, or like I'm 78, doesn't matter. When you get up in the morning, you should say, my best is yet to come. And maybe today is the day when it will come. So supposing you are 89 and that is the last day of your life, it doesn't matter. That day, you have to say that. And if a billion Indians do that every day, my best is yet to come, and not for myself, but for my country. What a great nation it will be. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.